Let us pray. Tell us what we need to hear, O God, and show us what we need to do to be disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, good evening, everybody. I bring you greetings from that 110 parishes, 40,000 Episcopalians, and apparently hundreds of thousands of rats and other vermin from Baltimore, Maryland. Perhaps you've heard of us. The president referred to us this past summer, and we had some feelings about that, but more about that tomorrow. I just bring you greetings. It's out east in Maryland. You've heard of Maryland? You know, if you have a globe, Maryland is one of those states where you see Maryland out in the Atlantic Ocean with an arrow pointing there. You know, Maryland is that it's kind of a long state from the ocean all the way to Appalachia. It's long. It's like my spirituality. It's long but thin. There are three dioceses that have Maryland. Ours is the largest of the three, but Diocese of Washington is two-thirds of Maryland. Used to always be Maryland. Easton is on that eastern shore. There are over 250 churches in the state of Maryland, that little sliver of land. It's a lot of Episcopalians in Maryland, stemming back from the good old days when it was an Anglican colony. And so you could tax everybody to build all these churches there. Well, there's a lot going on in Maryland. Have you heard of us?
Yes.
Yeah, unfortunately. Now, we have a lot of good things going on. We've had our bumps, as you know, but you know about bumps. You know about some dashed dreams. You know about disappointment. We love you in Maryland. When we look at Fort Worth, and not just we in Maryland, but across the Episcopal Church, we greatly admire you. We need you. We are in awe of what you're doing in Fort Worth. Thank you. Thank you for bearing the brunt of the cost of a faithful witness to a compassionate, just, inclusive, spiritually energetic, and open Christianity. Thank you. And thank you, Scott. Where are you? I don't recognize him in all his finery. Scott, it is true that Scott and Kathy, just one of our great friends in the House of Bishops, and you had quite the bishop there. That address that he gave, or the three that he gave in that the one address. Yeah, thank him. I told him I'm going to use some of that. I'm going to use some of that in one or more of my convention addresses. And I'm going to say, here's something else I thought of, and I will not give you credit. But it shows the depth, doesn't it, that your bishop has, the spiritual depth, the theological depth, and the humanity for this man of God. You are very fortunate. Join me again in just thanking him for your time. Yes. Well, I want to call your attention to the gospel lesson that was chosen for this evening. Oh my gosh. Did you really read that parable? It's a real humdinger, isn't it? It sounds more like something that hedge fund managers or Wall Street money manipulators would be about, much less than something that our Lord would try to be telling people what to do. I just can't believe this parable is in the gospel. Perhaps the gospel writer got it wrong. He misheard what somebody gave to him, and he didn't quite get the punchline right in this thing, because, you know, you put all the parables of Jesus together, and this one sticks out like a sore thumb. It's like that old Sesame Street song, "One of these things is not like the other." And so I don't know I don't know what your Sunday school teachers were teaching the kiddies back when this gospel was assigned a few weeks ago. I don't know what they were talking about. I hope they weren't teaching this parable because it might scare them away. What in the world is going on? Well, I, being something of a student of the scriptures, I consulted Bible commentaries to see what they can do with this. And here's what I found out. The Bible is like a person. If you torture it long enough, you can get it to say anything. And so I tortured the thing, and I wrestled it, and I don't know. I think I got a message here. Y'all, you want to hear it?
Yes.
No, you really want to hear it?
Yes.
That's what I'm talking about. Let's go then. Okay, here you have the story. This man, this rich man, he had a lot of wealth, and apparently he found out that his manager was up to no good. There was a whistleblower, you see, who went to him, and we don't know who the whistleblower is, but that's kind of the way whistleblowing works. You're not really supposed to know who it is. That's a whole other subject. And so he got the intel that something's wrong, and so the manager is up to no good, and he says, you have to go and give me an account of the books. Yes, I'm looking at you. You have to give me an account because you can't be my manager any longer. You're out of here. And so the manager goes, damn. You know, this is not the way this is supposed to end up. What in the world am I going to do? I am not going to work. I'm not going to be a laborer. I'm not going to stand out there in front of the Walmart early in the morning, hoping to get chosen. That's just not my position. And I'm not going to beg. I'm not going to be like one of those squeegee boys in Baltimore on the corner who is going to wipe your windshield for, with the going rate is now about $2. I'm just not going to do that. I know what I'm going to do. And so he goes to the creditors, the debtors for this. And he goes to the one and says, how much are you into the old man for? The guy says, 100 jars of olive oil. Now, here's the only thing about this parable. Who in the world would get 100 jars of olive oil? But go with me here. 100 jars of olive oil. And the guy says, Joe, this is me. I tell you what, you can't pay that. Make it 50. It'll be fine. And Joe's going, oh man, that's good. Think nothing of it. You know, just, it's who I am. I'm a giver. And he goes to the other one. Mary, how much are you into the guy for? 100 bushels of wheat. Now, I don't know, 100 bushels of wheat? What was she in the... She had a side business going on. That's another thing about this parable. Oh, I'm out of my area. I'm sorry. I know this is my area. I'm going to stay in my area. 100 bushels of wheat. What in the world are you going to do with 100 bushels of wheat? She had kitchens or something going on. Anyway, Mary, I know you can't handle that. I tell you what. Give me your bill. I'm scratching that out. Make it 80. Mary, I can't help it. I'm just feeling large now. I just want to help you out. Don't worry about it. It's who I am. The guy was a crook. He was a swindler. He was a cheat. There was nothing really commendable about this guy. Except our Lord said, and the manager commended him for his shrewdness. And I tell you this, the children of God have to be as shrewd in knowing where to stand and where to stay within the lines and dealing with this world. You got to be like him, because that's a tough world out there. And there are people out there who want to do you harm, and you got to be smart. You got to go after it. was kind of outrageous. Because what in the world would commend that guy? Why in the world did the New Testament writers and those who compiled the scriptures, what did they see in this story? Well, what was the early church going through at that time? The early church was in crisis. It was in crisis when Luke was compiling his story. The early Christian movement that had shown so much growth, and Luke recorded it. People were being added to daily. You know, they were growing. They had new church starts everywhere. They had glossies with plans for expansion. And it was all just going somewhere so well. But by Luke's time, it's persecution. Things aren't going so well. Some of those plans for new ministries weren't panning out. And when persecution happens, it's not like a whole bunch of people saying, well, let me sign up for that. There were fewer converts. In fact, they were losing. They were losing. You know, most of life is losing, you know. Most of life is about losses. And maybe that's why I like baseball so much. I do like baseball. Because, you know, the best hitters in baseball are losers. They lose 70% of the time. You're a 300 hitter. You're one of the best hitters in baseball. That means you're a loser. And apparently in my neck of the woods, I was born and raised in Washington. And you know, Washington's a suburb of Boston, of Baltimore. And so, you know, when the Nats won, you know, I say, yeah, I'll take our losers over. Oh, that's right. There's some Houston Astros people here. Losers. Well, it's about time we won something in Washington. I know we had the Caps last year and the WNBA, the Mystics this year. So it was our turn. I grew up as a Washington Redskins fan. It's a tough room. Washington Redskins. I mean, you just get, you know, it was a Redskins town. And when I got elected Bishop of Maryland in March 29, 2008, I was elected bishop on the first ballot in Maryland when I know that 40 years earlier, I would not have been welcomed as a worshiper in most of the parishes in Maryland. It was a big day, March 29, 2008. The very next day, I was scheduled to preach at the National Cathedral. I was canon pastor at that time. And that was the 40th anniversary of the last sermon of Martin Luther King Jr. He gave it the National Cathedral. And I was preaching that day. And there, when I'm trying to consider that day, oh my gosh, I got to move from Washington to Baltimore. And the scripture lesson was Jesus talking about, don't worry about what you are to eat, what you are to wear, and all that. And then there was that line, consider the ravens. I've been considering them ever since that. The Redskins are losers. And so are the best hitters are losers. And that's what the church was facing. Everywhere they turned, it seemed they were losing. And when you think about where Luke placed this parable in that section of the gospel, it was a lot about losing, wasn't it? It was right there with the previously, it was the parable of the lost coin. The parable of the lost sheep. The parable of the lost son, the prodigal son. The parables about the loss of faith. Loss, loss, losing, losing, Y'all know something about losing? I know you do in your personal lives. You lose your youth. You lose your innocence. Sometimes we lose jobs. We lose our wherewithal. We lose money. We may lose our houses, our homes. We lose our health. We lose our life. In fact, most of life is managing loss. Managing loss. The loss of friends, the loss of loved ones, the loss of church properties, the loss of friendships. Do y'all know about losing? You're losers. I'm looking at a bunch of losers. Wouldn't it be great if sometimes you could get a win? In life, it's just wonderful. You cherish the wins because so much of it is losing. And here you have this outrageous story in the gospel where for some strange reason, everybody wins. This is a masterful parable. In this parable, the owner wins because he's going to get everything that he had already invested in. Because you know, I skipped the whole part, you know, that when I said he was a swindler. Yeah, you know, this manager was just taking it off the top. Chances are that original bill had only 50 jars of oil in the first place. He had just written in 100 earlier in the game. And that woman didn't buy 100 bushels of wheat. At most, it was 80. The owner got all his money back. The debtors, they won because now they owed less than they thought they did. The manager wins because he can show the owner, all the books are in order. You're getting everything back. Everybody wins. This was, I don't know how Jesus thought this story up. Where you can have all sorts of nonsense going on and everybody wins. And why do we always have to frame everything into a win-lose situation? That there are winners and that there are losers. Wouldn't it be great sometimes if you can just have a win-win where everybody wins? Just like in this parable, where everybody can win. And wouldn't that be great in our society today? Tomorrow, I'm going to be speaking more about the racial madness that we've all inherited. And whenever you start talking about racism and race matters and in our country, everybody clutches up. We don't want to talk about that because we know who lost in that for the first 350 plus years of our nation. And if we talk about doing something about that, it may mean that me and my people and my white skin, we're going to lose if something is appropriated for others like me, then I'm a loser and that can't happen. And we frame everything in terms of winners and losers instead of if we make some things right, maybe we all can win. It could happen. It does in that parable. And wouldn't it be great in the Episcopal Church if long time ago we could not frame so many things in terms of win-loss, but in terms of win-win, here's what I mean. You have some closely held beliefs, and that's fine. Let's be together. Let's both win here. And in this diocese, and we're behind you so much in this litigation, and we think that we are all on the side of the right here. But wouldn't it be wonderful, and I don't know how you do it. Is your chancellor still here? Where's the chancellor? Yep, she left. Wouldn't it be something? And I hope I'm not speaking out of turn here, Scott, because I know you think about this all the time. When you win this lawsuit, when you win it, might you start thinking even more about how can the other side, who have been so dishonest, how can they win also? How can we start framing this in terms of win-win? It's hard to do, and there aren't a whole lot of parables in the scriptures that you can point to. This is one of them. This is one of them. In Haiti, after the devastating earthquake in 2010, it's time to give relief to them and to rebuild. Do you know that the only religious institution that was asked by the Haiti government to come in there and stay for the long haul was the Episcopal Church? Among all the others, the Episcopal Church was chosen. Why? Two reasons. One, we do relief, that is, relief in a compassionate way to alleviate suffering, but we also do development. Episcopal relief and development, which means after you dish out the food and the clothing and all that, we don't cut and run. We're there for the long haul. And Haiti knew that. The Episcopal Church isn't just going to come in there and leave. We're going to stay a while because there's something to be done. That's the first reason. But here's the other. They saw that the Episcopal Church has a funny way of trying to embrace everybody and diversity. And that we wouldn't come there trying to say, oh, we have it right and you don't, and here are our beliefs, and if you're a Christian, you have to conform to our beliefs. They see the Episcopal Church as broad and inclusive and as welcoming and whose arms are as wide as Jesus's. Because in a funny kind of strange way, we take everybody. We don't turn anybody away. Even if you are a shrewd, dishonest manager, we're going to embrace you. The only way we can get to that point is if we have a fresh infusion of love in our church and spread it. Love is going to get us there because love doesn't seek its own benefit. Love seeks everybody's benefit, especially your enemies, especially those whom you just want to lose. You want them to lose so much, but love just goes, I can't get there. And that's the kind of love that your bishop was talking about earlier. And it's in 1 Corinthians 13. Can you put it up on the screens? Our presiding bishop puts it this way. If it ain't about love, it ain't about God. And if we in the Episcopal Church, led by you, the Diocese of Fort Worth, if you can't get a win-win out of your situation, then who can? And if not now, when? Let's say this together in three parts. This is the first third, that row there and half of this row, and then the middle section, and then the third on the left side of this auditorium here, that row and half of this. And take one verse at a time, one sentence at a time. First sentence, second sentence, third sentence. And let's read it aloud. If
I'm nothing. For I give away all my possessions. tongues, it will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end.
And now everyone, and now faith. My sisters and brothers, may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you all now and forever. Amen.